Hey, it's Brett, and this is Brett and Some Books. Today we are continuing Who Ate the First Oyster by Cody Cassidy. This chapter is called Who Discovered Soap? If the time of our species on Earth were a day, this happened 22 minutes before midnight, 4,500 years ago. On the morning of March 14th, 1942, Anne Schaeff Miller lay dying on a hospital bed in New Haven, Connecticut. A month earlier, the 33-year-old nurse had suffered a miscarriage and contracted a common infection. Despite state-of-the-art medical care, including blood transfusions and sulfa drugs, her temperature gradually climbed to 107 degrees, and she began slipping out of consciousness. She had, on the basis of all previous experience, fatal hemolytic streptococcus septicemia. Her doctor, John Bumstead, wrote in his notes, "Desperate, Dr. Bumstead procured an experimental drug from a lab in New Jersey. The drug was so rare that technicians would later recycle it from Miller's urine." A state trooper escorted the coarse, dark brown powder to Miller's bedside in New Haven, where the attending bacteriologist, Dr. Morris Tager, examined the foul-smelling drug with some concern and suspicion, he later wrote. Nevertheless, Dr. Tager injected it into Miller after that afternoon. By the next morning, her temperature had returned to normal, and Miller went on to outlive her initial prognosis by some 57 years. The experimental drug is now known as penicillin, and Anne Schaeff Miller's life is the first of more than 200 million it has since saved. Penicillin was the world's first antibiotic, a class of medications that has revolutionized humanity's fight against infections. But antibiotics are only humankind's second most effective weapon in our eternal struggle against malignant bacteria. No medical product, and perhaps no medical discovery, has ever saved more lives than soap. Ever since the Dutch glassmaker Antoine Philips van Leeuwenhoek peered through his microscope in 1668 and saw a living organism in his lens, we have slowly been coming to terms with just how many bacteria inhabit our world. Earth is so infested that if aliens ever visit, they'll likely declare our planet is bedbug-infested motel and promptly leave. Bacteria are on the pillow we sleep on at night and on the cereal spoon we use in the morning. Biologists estimate a single human hand plays host to 150 different species at any given moment. Most are harmless, some are beneficial, and some are murderous if they could only find a way past the skin. In densely populated cities, where these dangerous bacteria and diseases can be passed from one to hundreds with the twist of a doorknob, it's no exaggeration to say soap doesn't just make cities healthier, it makes them possible. Thanks to its antiquity, we will likely never know exactly how many lives soap has saved. The researchers at the Science Heroes website that tracks these things threw up their hands when I posed the question to them, but even the conservative estimates run in the hundreds of millions. And yet, it could save far more. According to a report by UNICEF, if every cook used soap, it would cut the world's rate of respiratory infections by 25% and cut diarrheal diseases in half. That alone would save more than a million lives every year. Soap is serially underestimated and underutilized because it suffers from a fundamental PR problem. It cleans away something you cannot see. That's a difficult conceptual leap for even the most educated among us. According to the U.S. Centers for Disease Control and Protection, doctors wash their hands half as frequently as they should. Soap also saves the life of a healthy person oblivious to the bullet they dodged. While an antibiotic can take someone like Miller from death's door to the dance floor overnight. So despite not only saving more lives than penicillin, but enabling our modern urban existence, We still underrate what is perhaps the greatest medical discovery in human history. Who discovered soap's recipe? I'll call her Nini, after the Sumerian goddess of medicine, Ninisina. And I'll call her a she, because soap's discoverer likely worked in Sumeria's burgeoning textile trade, which the anthropologist Joy McCorriston tells me was an industry dominated by women. Nini was born 4,500 years ago in what is now southern Iraq, perhaps in the ancient Sumerian city of Gersu, where the oldest written tablets detailing the manufacture of soap originate. Gersu was one of the world's first cities with a population in the tens of thousands, and was at one point the capital of ancient Lagash Kingdom. It is home, among many other humankind's firsts, to the world's oldest known bridge. Nini was born around the time of the construction of the Great Pyramid of Giza, and other than being slightly shorter than the average person today, was completely modern in appearance. In their cuneiform tablets, Sumerians often referred to themselves as the dark-haired people. Though many Sumerian statues feature big blue eyes, most historians believe this was a feature of their gods and that blue-eyed Sumerians were actually quite rare. Nini's eyes, like her hair, were probably dark. Pictographs suggest that Nini's likely wore garments of fringed fleece or sheepskin that fell to her ankles, which she embellished and decorated with patterns, while men wore kilts and sashes. Nini grew up in a bleakly patriarchal society, according to the Mesopotamian scholar and author of Women in Ancient Mesopotamia, Karen Nemet Najat. Her father was the head of her household and exercised authority over her until he died or she was married, which may have happened when she was a teenager or sometimes even younger. One Akkadian text describes a wife as 3 feet tall at the time of her wedding. Marriage for Nini was a contract between her father and her father-in-law. Sumerians viewed a woman's marriage as less to her groom than to her family. So if Nini's husband should die, she would likely be remarried to one of his brothers. Women in Sumeria had virtually no prospects for independence, according to Nemet Najat, and at the time in Nini's life would have been independent of either her father, her father-in-law, or her husband. Nini's primary role as a wife was to bear children, especially sons, who were viewed as heirs. Marriage was traditionally monogamous, but if she did not mother children, a husband might take a second wife or a concubine, or adopt. In a hymn, the goddess Yula describes a Sumerian woman's life in simple terms. I am a daughter, I am a bride, I am a spouse, I am a housekeeper. Nini likely grew up lower class because in addition to being a housekeeper, she had a far more modern role. The Mesopotamians, among their many gifts to humanity, invented the finger-numbing drudgery of factory labor and textile mills. These large state-run industries depended on enslaved labor, debtors, and quasi-employees to shear, sew, dye, and produce woolen textiles, a critical export for many Mesopotamian cities. By the time of Nini's employ, Gersu's textile factories were large-scale production centers, impressive even by modern standards. The archaeologist Daniel Potts calculates that in a three-month period, 203,310 sheep were shorn in Gersu alone, a number made even more thank you, Flower, for mixing it up a little bit. A number made even more impressive since it was achieved before the invention of sheep shears. Instead of efficiently cutting their wool, sheep shearers plucked each individual strand, one by one, from all 200,000 sheep, because of this painstaking pace, Potts estimates that a single weaver only produced an average of 10 inches of wool per day. Yet according to the Assyriologist Benjamin Studevant Hickman, thanks to as many as 10,000 laborers, a single textile factory in Ur produced more than 400 tons of wool in a single year. Nini, it seems, was one of these workers. She may have even occupied a position of some authority. Female supervisors typically managed 30-person teams in these factories, according to archaeologist Rita Wright, and received higher wages in the form of both barley or cloth. Given Nini's influence in introducing soap to the manufacturing process, perhaps she was one of these supervisors. The first documented use of soap is described on a cuneiform tablet found in Gersu. According to chemical archaeologist Martin Levy, the tablet was written 4,500 years ago and concerns the washing and dyeing of wool. To properly dye wool, a weaver must first remove the lanolin fats from the textiles, which is accomplished far more easily with soap. Even today, weavers wash freshly sheared wool in soapy water to remove the lanolin. Nini was far from the first person to take advantage of the chemical reaction between alkalis and fats, what chemists call saponification. The ingredients are common enough that most scholars suspect someone long before Nini first created the reaction accidentally, according to Seth Rasmussen, a professor of chemistry at North Dakota State University with whom I spoke. Alkalis are found in the ashes of burned wood, and many scholars believe early humans used wet ash to clean greasy butchering tools. Unbeknownst to the cleaner, ash combined with the animal grease to create a simple, impure soap. The fact that wet ash removed grease was probably understood by the first weavers as well, who likely used it to clean their textiles. According to Hugh Salzberg, author of From Caveman to Chemist, the ash would have combined with the wool's lanolin to create saponification. Yet there's reason to believe no one discovered one could make soap itself, which one could then wash one's hands with, before 5,000 years ago, according to Rasmussen, because there's no mention of soap for the first millennia of Mesopotamia writing. Most scholars believe soap was discovered in some proximity to its first mention in tablets 4,500 years ago. If it was known long before Sumerian times, we would expect to see references to it in earlier Sumerian records, which we don't, Rasmussen tells me. Nini's stroke of genius was likely the moment she discovered the fatty lanolin, or the animal grease, was the reason ash worked so well with cleaning agent and could be added to ashy water to create a bucket of liquid soap. It may seem a small step, but it meant Nini no longer relied on the grease of whatever she was washing to aid the reaction. Instead, she could create the ideal mix of fats and alkalis and wash anything, especially, and most critically, human hands. Nini's first soap, Salzberg theorizes, may have been a bucket of ashy, greasy water. Later, either Nini or someone else realized they could strain the ash and globules of fat away, as water absorbs the alkali from the ash in the process called leaching. Because few people would have been interested in washing themselves with ashy water, leaching was another important step in encouraging people to use soap for its most useful purpose. Eventually, and up through the Middle Ages, soap makers skipped the strainer and dipped sacks of ash into water like tea bags. The first known recipe for soap calls for approximately 1 quart of oil and 6 quarts of potassium leached from wood ash. According to Rasmussen, this would have combined to create an impure but useful liquid soap. Using this crude formula to produce her ashy, greasy water, Nini would have made the most life-saving medical product ever developed by humankind, except she wouldn't have known it. Soap is not a bacteria destroyer like penicillin. Instead, it is a bacteria remover. By creating molecules that attach to both oil and water, soap creates what chemists describe as an oil suitcase, allowing water to briefly coexist with oil. Any bacteria hiding within or beneath it can then be washed away. Because the life-saving effect of soap is so difficult to observe, it's unlikely Nini received much recognition or acknowledgement in her lifetime, nor would she have had any idea what she had done. Perhaps she received some recognition at the textile plant for her slightly more efficient method for cleaning off lanolin. An increase in her allotment of barley, perhaps. Sumerians almost certainly didn't wash their hands with soap for the same reason modern doctors often fail to, because their hands already look clean. For hundreds of years after its invention, there's no evidence anyone used soap to clean their bodies. Instead, it was used on items like dishes or clothing that had obvious grease stains. The first proof that anyone used soap to clean their skin comes from a cuneiform tablet found in the Hittite capital of Bagashkoi and written nearly 1,000 years after Nini. The tablet reads, "With water I bathed myself, with soda I cleansed myself, with soda from a shiny basin I purified myself, with pure oil from the basin I beautified myself, with the dress of heavenly kingship I clothed myself." All technologies, no matter how significant a breakthrough they represent, take time to spread throughout a population. Economists call this leg technological diffusion, and Nini's discovery suffered a particularly elongated one. Global adoption of soap is, as we've seen, still underway, and 5,000 years progression has been hardly linear. Beyond Mesopotamia, soap's adoption was even more haphazard and often neglected for objectively worse alternatives. Instead of soap, Roman launderers used purified urine collected from passers-by. Pliny the Elder credited soap's discovery to the Gauls, the barbarians, who used soap instead of urine. The Greeks primarily washed themselves with soapless water, even though Galen, the Greek physician, presciently recommended its use as a preventative medical treatment. The failure to understand soap's power to save lives persisted, not only because bacteria were invisible, but because they were drastically misunderstood. Even as late as the 1800s, the mere suggestion that microorganisms might be lethal could get one fired from one of the most advanced hospitals in the world. In 1847, Dr. Ignaz Semmelweis, a Hungarian obstetrician working at the Vienna General Hospital, began investigating a mystery. Why did birthing mothers under the care of his doctors die at a rate of 5 times greater than by those cared for only by his midwives? Semmelweis insisted his doctors follow every one of his midwives' birthing techniques. He even went so far as to ban priests from ringing bells in the doctors' wards because they didn't in the midwives. Nothing worked. But when a colleague of Semmelweis's died after performing an autopsy of the same maternal fever that plagued mothers, he tried a new theory. He knew his doctors often performed autopsies before they assisted mothers, while midwives did not. Perhaps, he reasoned, they carried some deadly particle or smell from cadavers to mothers, and thus he asked them to wash their hands. The death rate immediately plunged, but Semmelweis's doctors quickly mutinied at the suggestion they were responsible for killing their patients. He was fired. The doctors stopped washing their hands, and Semmelweis eventually perished in an insane asylum. Nimi, the Assyrian textile worker, born thousands of years before him, probably suffered a similarly anonymous passing. Average life expectancy in ancient Sumeria is estimated at only 40 years, in part because early cities were cesspools of disease and infection. as Nini lived amid a dense population with not a soul who washed their hands with soap, she may have died from the very kind of bacterial infection her discovery saves millions from today. That's the end of that chapter. If you'd like more, check out the playlist for this book and like and subscribe.